Hi, I'm ready to go. Great, thank you. Okay, hi. Let's get going. All right. How are we all doing? Good. So let's see. I guess the mini project one has been graded, and we're still working on mini project two. We still have one or two to come in, apparently. And mini project three will be, well, it's actually on the website now. It's officially coming out on Wednesday, and then you have 2 weeks to do that. I've gotten some information about project ideas from, I think, most of you at this point, if not everyone. And I haven't responded to all of those, but I will do that within the next day. I'm sorry for the delay in doing that, but they sound interesting, and I think we're going to get some great projects, so I'm looking forward to that. Any issues or questions before we get going? Okay, so what I want to talk about today is some different ways of representing audio, music audio, a way of representing the tonal content, the different notes in the audio, but without having to go all the way to actually transcribing all the individual notes, polyphonic pitch tracking or full music transcription, because that's still not very easy. But there's this intermediate format called Chroma, which you can use, and I'll explain what that is. And that turns out to be particularly suitable for recognizing the chords, which is sort of an intermediate description of the music content. It's not saying what the individual notes are, but a chord sort of defines a set of notes that are working together, and there are some, it's not explicit about which specific notes there are, but there's sort of, it's this fairly good musical constraint on what the notes are. So it turns out that's easier than picking out the individual notes, but it's still musically interesting. You know, the idea of describing music by its chord progression is something that predates our automatic techniques. And then that's what the practical on Wednesday will be about, chord recognition. And the mini project, the third mini project, is basically extending that and trying to see if you can get some improved results. And so this is very much moving into sort of the final phase of the class, which is about analyzing music. Because now we're taking, this is also very much the angle we take in my research group, where we treat music signals or other audio signals as this complex data and try and get some high-level information out, something like the chord sequence or other kind of transcription. So the foundation or the starting point for that whole area of research is this situation we find ourselves in, where we have very large music databases. So we have, you know, on our computers or in our pockets, we have these huge collections of music audio data, and that seems like an interesting computational problem. That there must be things we can do with computers. Computers are good at handling large amounts of data, and so there should be things that we can do to take advantage of these new kinds of databases, data sets, to solve interesting problems. The kind of interesting problem we might want to solve is navigation, finding something within that data set that meets some need, for instance, finding the piece of music that you want to listen to. It's I guess this depends on, I mean, I guess this varies with individuals, but for me, it's still very much like I'm still working in the kind of, you know, 20th century mindset that if I want to listen to a piece of music, firstly, I expect it to be in the collection of stuff that I own. So there's this finite set of stuff that I'm going to draw it from. And secondly, to find it, I'm just going to, I know what it's called. I know, hopefully I know what it's called, and I can just go and find it and listen to it. And that, even though there are many alternatives now, that's a remarkably resilient mode of access in that I still do it rather than anything else. But I guess part of that is what you're used to. So the idea is, at some level, you've got this collection of music, and maybe you'd want to listen to some piece, but there may be thousands of individual tracks that you could choose. And you've got this problem of trying to choose one of them. And so a lot of work in this area takes this metaphor of thinking of each track as a point in some Euclidean space, some dimensional space. Although, and the thing about high-dimensional spaces is we're pretty good about having intuitions about two- and three-dimensional spaces, because that's the space that we operate in. Mathematically, there's nothing particularly special about three dimensions. We can use as many dimensions as we like, and we can, you know, calculate things like angles and distances in these higher dimensions. But they're very weird to think about. But one thing we can do is define some signal processing. We've heard about this in a couple of the presentations on music classification. We define some features. If we define them right, we can calculate them for an entire track, entire piece of music, and then we can represent that track as this point in high-dimensional space whose individual elements, coordinates, are given by these features. And then the idea is that we try and construct a space such that neighborhoods in this space correspond to similar kinds of music that the listener would consider similar. And so if you want to find a particular piece of music, you can maybe say, well, I'm looking for something a bit like this. It'll take you to that point in space, and then you can explore the neighborhood around there. Let me just show you. This is obviously a screenshot of something like that. Here's the actual program I used to generate that screenshot. It's a program called Gobi, or this particular version is called GGobi. And what it does is it takes just a flat data file. So here's the input data, which is just, you know, for each row is a track with a name of the track and then a set of individual feature dimensions. And the dimensions actually are, this is using the MEL Kepstraw features, which I'll talk about in a second, and it's the means, the nine means and the standard deviations of the first nine dimensions. And this data file has 1,400 tracks in it, which is some particular data set we use, a data set of six albums from each of 20 artists, which it works out to be 1,400 tracks or so. And so what we can do with this, with GGobi, it'll let you do various things where it basically takes the high-dimensional data and projects it down onto 2D so you can look at it. But you can choose the different dimensions that you use. So here I've selected the first five standard deviations, the MFCCs, and then it will let you sort of move them around. And so what it's doing is it's basically taking a random walk in this higher dimensional space, changing the, you can't see too many of them. There are a bunch of different colors in there. But it's just projecting them all, and then, you know, there are an awful lot of ways of projecting even six-dimensional data on two dimensions, but it's randomly changing them. If you look at these axes here, are how each dimension gets projected down to 2D, and so you can see it's just moving them around. But that gives you the sense of this kind of cloud of points. And then if there is structure, if you're lucky, you'll see these kind of ridges or lines or clusters. The colors here are related to the actual artist. And so if I select that, then when I look at these, it'll tell me what each individual track is. So this is a Queen track, and right next to it is a Depeche Mode track. This one's a real outlier. I don't know, there's obviously something weird about the acoustics of that one that sends it out. Over here we have a bunch of Green Day tracks, which are nicely clustered. That's nice, that's what you want to see. And it's also, it makes sense, because Green Day has a particular, you know, particular kind of acoustic style. These MFCCs, as we'll see in a moment, are very much based around the texture or the broad kind of spectral balance. So, but here's Madonna right next to The Cure and Led Zeppelin. I don't know. These purple ones are the Beatles. There's equal representation of all the different artists here, so it is somewhat meaningful if you see a couple of artists next to each other. The colors are not unique, of course. But anyway, you get the idea that what we'd like to do is find some way of rendering these tracks into a high-dimensional space, such that the points, the similar tracks are nearby, and tracks that we would consider dissimilar are far apart in space. And there's been tons of research on doing this, because it's a tough problem that no one can really, it's not easily solved. And the biggest problem, of course, is just that the features that we use to decide whether two pieces of music are similar or not are quite a lot more sophisticated than things that we can easily calculate from the audio. And there's an argument that even the Euclidean, the idea of putting them in a Euclidean space isn't quite right, because one of the constraints of Euclidean space is that if A is similar to B and B is similar to C, then A and C must be similar as well. That's transitivity and similarity. But sometimes you can say, well, A is similar to B because, you know, they're by the same artist, and B is similar to C because they both have saxophone or something. But now A and C are not by the same artist, and they don't both have saxophones, so they're not similar, and so you get this non-Euclidean similarity space. But that's... if that was our only problem, we'd be in good shape. We just can't even get a good measure of this stuff. So what kind of dimensions can we use for this? Well, we can try and look at the timbre, the sort of the overall nature of the sound. In particular, it turns out that if we use these Mel frequency Kestrel coefficients, we get features which we get a system which tends to cluster songs by which have the same kind of instruments in, or the same instruments recorded in the same way, or the same combinations of instruments, which is actually pretty good, because if I tell you what instruments a particular piece of music involves, you're better than random at guessing what kind of music it is, right? That's very characteristic of the music. But if we're not, there's stuff other than the instruments going on, of course. There's the notes. And the interesting thing is you can take the same piece of music and with the same notes, the same chords, and play it on different instruments. It'll look very different under these kinds of features. But there are other times when you won't be able to find that. And so the chroma features are a different kind of feature that are trying to sort of get at the notes and not get at this information. So these are a nice complementary pair. And then there's also temporal information, the information of how the song evolves in time, things like the tempo that we talked about last week and various complications on top of that. These are the kinds of things you can practically pull from the audio at the moment. There are other kinds of information you could think about trying to use, but they're harder to get if you've only got the audio to start with. Okay, so let's talk about these MFCCs. which I guess we've heard about a little bit as well, because they're very commonly used for this kind of task, and they work surprisingly well. MFCC's Mel frequency Kestrel coefficients are kind of the standard feature in speech recognition, and they were developed for use in speech recognition. But almost any other audio classification task that's been tried, people try MFCCs because they have the tools around to calculate them, and they often find they work extremely well. And in fact, it's often difficult to find anything that does better than MFCCs. And it's also true in speech recognition. There's nothing totally compelling about why MFCCs should be the features that work so well in speech. And so people regularly look at ways of developing better features and rarely find anything that can compete. And I guess one of the reasons that people keep looking is because there doesn't seem to be anything irresistible about what the MCCs are. It seems like, you can see that would sort of work, but maybe there are other things that would work better. And that makes me personally think that maybe we don't completely understand what it is about MFCCs that works so well. They're just something we've sort of stumbled upon that does work well. Let me explain what they are. So we take the sound, we chop it up into short frames, like 30 millisecond frames or something. We take the Fourier transform to get the spectrum. So here's the sound waveform, this is time. Look at the blue curve first. You take the spectrum, which gives us the blue curve here. This is a piece of voiced speech, so it has this nice periodic structure, which in the spectral domain comes out as these regularly spaced harmonic peaks. We then map this to a log or a nonlinear axis, the Mel scale. That's where the Mel part comes in. The Mel scale was developed in the 1920s by some psychologists who were trying to come up with a frequency scale, where the changes in frequency were judged to be equally large by listeners. And so MEL is sort of short for melodic scale, because, you know, notes in a musical scale are supposed to be uniformly spaced. The MEL scale is not a straight log frequency scale, which would be spacing things according to the musical scale. It's log frequency above 1 kilohertz, but then it becomes linear below 1 kilohertz, which is based on actually psychological reality that at low frequency, if you were using log, then you become very, very sensitive to small differences, and you don't become that sensitive. Your ability to judge musical intervals kind of falls apart at very low frequencies. But the Mel scale is kind of, this is the only place it's used. There are much better scales of auditory frequency sensitivity now, like the Bach scale. But this, for some kind of accidental reason, this Mel features were developed in the late 1970s, early 1980s, and the engineers who were working on it then, just that was the first thing they found. So this is the Mel scale, which just makes these things further apart and these things closer together, but otherwise it's pretty much the same. And then we take the log of the magnitude of the spectrum. So that's here. Now this is just each peak becomes this kind of more rounded thing. And whereas here, you know, these values are close to zero. Now on the log scale, we can sort of see some detail in the valleys. And so these large peaks here in the linear scale are now not that much larger than their neighbors in the log scale, because, you know, they're only a factor of 2, which in this log scale or in this dB scale is only 3 dB or whatever. We take this log spectrum, and then we take the inverse Fourier transform of this, or essentially another Fourier transform of this. This is similar.
Inverse Fourier transform log.
Yeah, we just take this signal, this blue curve, and we take an inverse Fourier transform. I call it inverse Fourier transform because we're sort of still sort of in the Fourier domain, right? We've got an axis here which is related to frequency. And so we would think about taking that and doing a Fourier transform to get it back into the time domain. But of course, it's not frequency anymore because we mapped it. And so what we get back is not the time domain. We saw this before in pitch tracking when we had a capsule pitch tracker. So taking the Fourier transform of the log magnitude spectrum gives you the capstrum. But this is the inverse or the Fourier transform of the log Mel axis spectrum. And so this is the Mel capstrum, which is different. The reason we took one of the obvious benefits of taking the regular capstrum is that these spectral peaks, we take the log of this thing, the magnitude of this thing, these spectral peaks are regularly spaced. When we take the Fourier transform, these regularly spaced peaks become, you know, we detect the periodicity and we get a nice spike at the period of the excitation. But here we've done this Mel warping, so these things are not regularly spaced anymore. And when we take the Fourier transform, we don't get a clear peak coming corresponding to the pitch. That's because in the Mel features, we're not interested in pitch. They were developed for speech, and we wanted to make the features independent of pitch, so that if people say the same words at different pitches, they still look the same after they've been transformed. And so in capstral pitch tracking, you look at these large lags, which correspond, or large indexes, which correspond to the spacing of the harmonics. In the Mel frequency capsule coefficients, you just look at the first few bins. So what you're doing is looking at a very low order Fourier approximation to this spectrum. So basically you're smoothing it so that you only keep the slowly varying components, right? So the blue curve gives you this blue capstrum here. But then what we do is we basically take some number like 12 or 13, we set all the values larger than that equal to zero, and that's the red curve. And so now if we work backwards to see what we got, the capstrum, these 12 red values correspond to this shape in the log Mel spectrum domain. And so you can see it's got basically the shape of these things, but it's been smoothed out because basically we've removed all these higher frequency Fourier terms, so it can't vary rapidly enough. This is what you get if you try and represent this blue line with just the first 12 Fourier components, the first things that make up the 12 cycles in the...
What is the mathematical function for the red curve?
The red curve is the sum of, you know, it's like 180 plus 5 times cosine whatever this thing is, cosine omega t, where we get, that'll give us one cosine omega, plus 2 times cosine 2 omega, plus minus 1 times cosine 3 omega, plus 2 times cosine 4 omega, that kind of thing, right? So it's just setting up this function with a set of cosine terms.
Can you do the transform again back to get the red curve step by step?
Yeah, so then that's the log magnitude on the Mel scale is that set of cosine terms. They're cosine terms because the blue curve is, of course, symmetric in positive and negative frequency. It's a magnitude spectrum. So when you do the Fourier analysis here, you just get the cosine terms. There are no sine terms because there are no anti-symmetric terms. They're all symmetric. But, okay. So that's the log. Then you take the inverse, you exponentiate the magnitude, and you get this curve. And then you undo the warping, you get this curve. So this is now a linear magnitude spectrum. And then you can try and find, you can do an inverse Fourier transform of that to give you this red waveform. There are many waveforms that have this magnitude spectrum. So there's an arbitrary phase in here, but it's sort of something like you could, in theory, do that. It has what does it have? It doesn't have anything, actually. It appears to have some periodicity because it's got this peak here. But it's actually the wrong periodicity, so it's like it's not at all meaningful. It's meant to be if we'd smoothed it out perfectly, it would be the impulse response of the vocal tract. That's the kind of thing we're trying to get to. Because that's the point about Mel features, is they're trying to get the broad shape of the spectrum, but stripping out the periodic excitation detail. And in speech recognition, that makes a lot of sense because we've got this idea of formants, that we've got the source filter model. The source is giving us the pitch. The filter, which is just these, you know, these LPC like a few poles, give us these resonances. Like up here, this sort of looks like it did about the right job. There's a peak here, and you know, it's there are a couple of harmonics under this, but it's just found as one single peak. But you don't really go back here. We're not using an LPC model here. We're just saying this spectrum, after we've done our modifications, after we've warped the frequency axis and taken it as the log magnitude, it has a broad shape. We're not interested in these individual peaks because they're about the pitch, which for speech recognition we don't want. So we just want to sort of know the general shape. So it turns out the first 8 or 10 or 12 of these Kestrel coefficients give us that information. And that's MFCCs. So the advantages are they describe the spectrum in a few coefficients, right? In 12 coefficients rather than, 256 or something. They're basically describing the spectral magnitude. So if we shift this window over by 5 milliseconds, the phases of these Fourier terms will change, but the magnitudes won't change. So the Kestrel won't change very much. So they're sort of somewhat time invariant if the signal remains the same, which is what we want. It turns out that they have very little correlation. That if you take a bunch of speech signals like this, calculate their MFCCs for every 30 millisecond frame. So now you've got this, time by 12 dimensions, this big matrix. If you then calculate the correlation between the different different dimensions, it's close to zero, which is nice because that means if you then plot them in some high-dimensional space, they form these nice clusters which you can model with Gaussians without having to worry about the correlation between axes. Yeah.
Can speech signals really have that nice periodic?
This is a real speech signal, yes. They don't have it all the time.
Okay.
But if I go, that's pretty much a periodic signal. Yeah, but even, so that was like, half a second, but when I say a regular word, the in word is like 200 milliseconds or 150 milliseconds. Yeah, so this is 20 milliseconds. Is it really? So this must be female voice because this is like 5 millisecond period or 4 millisecond period, so that's like 250 hertz or something, which is high, would be high for me. But my normal, my normal voice pitch is about 100 hertz, which is 10 milliseconds per period. So, but a vowel will last anything from 30 to 150 milliseconds. So it'll be multiple cycles. You can definitely see the periodicity like this. Okay, so now you know what MFCCs are, and that's where they come from. They're there because they're good for speech, and they, basically you take this, you've got this 12-dimensional space, and individual format configurations will land up as particular clusters in this 12-dimensional space. It's a very nice approach for recognizing vowels anyway, and it works well for other things. One of the problems with designing features, you want them to do the right thing in the cases that you can think about, but you also want them to sort of be reasonable in cases which are different from the ones you thought about. So nice, compared to LPC is very good at picking out vowels, right? Picking out formats, it's saying, and looking for these resonances, you model it, it finds resonances if they're there. But of course, some of the time in speech, the resonance model isn't so great. Then LPC kind of does random things and it'll start putting resonances in some unpredictable place. Kestrel coefficients, it's like I'm just smoothing the spectrum, I'm just representing the smooth spectrum. You give me any spectrum, I can smooth it, I can represent it as these cosine terms. And so even if your original model of a bunch of resonances, a bunch of formants doesn't fit the data, the MFCC doesn't get freaked out, right? It does something sensible anyway. And so that's part of their power, is that they degrade gracefully, that when things go wrong, they don't suddenly break. Okay, So that's MFCCs for speech, and like I say, just like it's this, and you know, the reason for the 30 millisecond window in speech is because, well, that's long enough to cover more than one pitch cycle. So that if you make it too short, if you make it like a 5 millisecond window, then you get different parts of the pitch cycle, which will have different spectral properties. 30 milliseconds, you're getting an entire pitch cycle, so you're sort of seeing whatever spectral properties are there, but it's not so long that you're getting multiple phonemes. It's short enough that it's rare for a phoneme to change much within 30 milliseconds. So it's very speech specific, but then people go and use the same framework of 30 millisecond frames and, you know, 12 ML frequency capture coefficients, and they use it for anything, for, you know, recognizing machine sounds, recognizing gunshots, and then in this case, characterizing music, and it still basically turns out to be a very good solution in almost all cases. Okay, so here's an example. Here's a log spectrogram. So it's basically a spectrogram where the color shows you the energy, but it's now on a log frequency axis, just so we get something that's a little more musically relevant. And then these are the, just taking the MFCC. So I thought I fixed that. It looks a little blurry, but basically there are only 13 or 14 dimensions here. So it's like you can see the individual rows of the data. We're still working on this 30 millisecond frame. So there's actually, you know, this is now 25 seconds of audio. There's quite a lot of columns here, but there aren't very many rows. Yeah.
What's the excitement? Is it LPC?
No. Let me tell you what that is. So here we've got the signal as MFCC. You can see here, I mean, this isn't the greatest picture because the scale's not very big here, but you can sort of, it makes sense that you can see these nice events here where there is something happening, and then there's energy in here, and you can see these stripes, which are the individual harmonics. Here, it's really hard to see anything. I mean, there's clearly, when you get something which is more or less stationary in the music, it's more or less stationary in the MFCCs, but you can't really say very much. And what the sixth MFCC is saying, when I decompose the log spectral magnitude warped on the Mel scale, having this cosine that completes 6 half cycles in between 0 and the maximum frequency is useful as part of that decomposition. But that's not a very strong feature. The only one that makes any sense is C0, the zeroth coefficient, which is the offset, the average level. And here you can see this follows the average energy. So these red blobs correspond to each of these events here. C1 is the one that starts at 1 and goes down to -1. So it's like the overall spectral tilt. And that sort of makes sense sometimes, that you can sort of see it's going from green to yellow here. So it starts off, I mean, maybe at the beginning of these events, they're brighter, and then they get duller, and so you get this sort of thing changing. But basically, MFCCs are not something you can read very usefully. Okay, so what is this third row? Here, I went back up the column on the red to generate the red things to get the smoothed spectrum, but just the information that's contained in these 12 capture coefficients, and then I used noise filtering to get energy out of that. So this basically, and I'm about to play this to you, this tells us what acoustic information is present in here so that we can listen to, and so because we use the noise, the actual fine structure is not informative. So let's listen to this. Here's the original, Let It Be. So it starts off with a piano, okay, fine, and then we have voice. So I'm guessing you're familiar with that one. Okay, so here we take short frames, but we only have this pretty coarse, you know, we start off with probably like 20-30 milliseconds at, you know, at 16 kilohertz sampling rate or something is 500 points. So we start off with probably 256 points in the spectrum here. Then we reduce it to just 12 or 13 coefficients. And then we invert it out and resynthesize. thinking about what the original sounds like. It's going a lot. So it's horrifying, yeah, but it's kind of interesting, right? I mean, it's always surprising to hear that, because like, this sounds like something, right? It sounds like someone smashing big cardboard boxes or something, I don't know. But you can hear it's like, oh, okay, yeah, so I can hear the energy shape of the piano that starts off with this attack and then decays away. Yeah, so in the previous slide, this is now going to want to play the demos again. But, okay. When we took the capstrum, we could get back to this, right? That's just a simple inversion. But then this doesn't directly give you a time waveform because, well, it's by now there's no phase information. The phase is all zero. You can take an inverse, but that's
basically
not necessarily what you want.
Result of inverse is like,
well, no. So what I do is I take a white noise sequence, and then at every frame I replace its magnitudes with these, and then I resynthesize. Then I invert it and overlap add, and that just gives me some information underneath. Which if I just resynthesize these, like that's an implicit. It's like I'm implicitly taking an impulse at every frame and then filtering it. And so you'd hear this buzzing, which was frame synchronous. And by using the noise excitation, the frame gets washed out. So we hear the events of the piano, and you can't hear the notes, obviously, because the tonal information is gone. So that's confirming that we've just kept the overall shape. I guess it doesn't sound like a piano anymore, but it turns out that if I played you a violin and a piano, and then I did this to both of them, you'd be able to tell which one was the violin and which one was the piano, because the piano is the one with the big crashes, and the violin has softer. So there's still information about which instrument is being preserved. And then the surprising thing is when the voice comes in, and you can understand what it's saying, right? And that's really this point about the power of MFCCs is that, yes, they do capture the necessary language information, because this smoothed out spectrum is actually enough for our speech perception processes to figure out language. It's like that level of spectral detail and the way it moves is actually enough to sound like speech to us. And the amazing thing is that even though it's speech plus this accompaniment of the piano, you can still pick out the speech. And you know, it's remarkable, but it does sound pretty weird. And clearly, it's not music, or doesn't have melody anymore. Okay. So what we then do is take those MFCCs. So we take a 3-minute track, convert it into what? Like 200 seconds times maybe 100 frames a second or 50 frames a second, so a few thousand feature vectors per track. And then we calculate, so now we have those long strips of MFCCs, and we calculate the mean and the covariance for each dimension. So we have whatever, 12, I think I actually... I end up using 20 MFCC dimensions, so in a little bit further to get a little bit more detail, but not very many. So 20 means, and then a 20 by 20 covariance matrix, which is only 190 or something in independent dimensions. But so each track is now represented as like about 200 dimensions. And, here we go, yeah. And then... Now I've got, for a particular artist, I can look at all their tracks. So this database of multiple albums, I get, you know, about 60 tracks per album, like 60 tracks per artist. I use 50 of them to estimate these means and covariances, which is basically estimating a Gaussian shape, you know, fitting a Gaussian blob to that artist's data. I do that for all 20 artists, and then I take the remaining one album's worth of tracks and find the points, and then find which Gaussian they're closest to, which Gaussian has the highest value for each point, and that's my classification. And so, and then I can do that for all 6 albums. I train on 5 albums, test on the 6th for all artists. And this is my classification rate. So the actual accuracy is 55%, which is not that great. You know, half the time I'm getting the artist wrong. But I'm choosing the artist 1 from 20. And some of these are not, they're not totally distinct artists, right? They're quite confusable. And so this is, you know, it's really, given that we're only starting with those kind of, you know, ghostly versions of the tracks, and we're not even doing that, because then we just take the time axis and collapse it and just treat them as a set of points of the individual Kestrel MSCC features. This is quite impressive that it works. And so, and if you look at the confusion, so this diagonal here is saying these are the ones that we got right. These are the true labels. So if we take Led Zeppelin, we weren't that good at classifying it. We confused it with Aerosmith, with also the Beatles, Creedence Clearwater Revival, not very impressive, The Cure, Depeche Mode, very embarrassing, not at all like Depeche Mode, but anyway. And then Prince. I know these confusions don't make a lot of sense, but if we look at something like Suzanne Vega here, we've got a big confusion with Dave Matthews. Isn't that interesting? But it's because they're not, I mean, although obviously clearly their voices are very different, their instrumentation is not that different. I mean, they're using kind of these nicely produced, well-recorded instruments. You can always come up with, this is another classic problem with this work. You look at this thing, the computer says, oh, I've listened to your music and I've decided that Dave Matthews and Suzanne Vega are similar. And you think, wow, that's so clever. This thing is so sophisticated, it's understood that they have the same kind of, you know, influences or something like this. And no, it just found that they, you know, they're mixed in the same way or something like that. So you have to be very cautious when trying to interpret the behavior of these things. But the confusions make no sense. I guess the best thing to say is, but it does actually get the right artist quite a lot of the time, which is showing that it's not behaving at random. If it were behaving at random, you get 5% correct. Do you want to?
But did you try other machine learning tools or library before as to do the classification?
Yeah, there's been a lot of work done in this area. Right, and so this is not a particularly strong machine learning approach. I have done this with support vector machines, which are typically much better at learning these kinds of things.
Well, what is the accuracy of the support vector machine?
I don't remember. It's better than this, but it's not dramatically better. It's surprising that the Gaussian models do quite well here, but I'm not sure if I've done it on the same, you know, test setup. Yes, so it's supervised learning, so exactly. I have the labels, I have a bunch of training data, I train a model for each artist and then test on the main. So there's a lot of work in this area. Artist identification isn't the most popular task. The most popular task is genre recognition, as we've heard about, the same kind of thing. The reason I was interested in artist identification is because genres tend to be very obviously different, like classical versus pop, you know, there's huge differences. So I was interested in trying to do discrimination amongst a set of data that wasn't quite so obviously separate. So it was all basically pop, and so there wasn't really, the genre labels aren't different here. They all have, you know, the same 2 or 3 genre labels. But the problem with artist recognition is you end up, there are the possibilities you're picking up on these other factors, like, you know, all these albums by this particular artist have been recorded by the same engineer using the same kind of microphones or something. And so you might be just learning stuff that isn't important to a listener, but which the machine's very good at picking up. And plus, artist identification is not a huge problem because you almost always have it in the metadata, right? It's not like something that we're going to be able to suddenly discover things that we didn't know before. But it's a nice, it's a well-defined, the good thing about it is the right answer is well-defined, right? Unlike genre, you know, we can argue about whether this is rock or pop, but we're normally agreed whether this is by the Beatles or Led Zeppelin. Okay, so that's MFCCs, and like I say, they're the sort of the standard thing that people resort to when they're looking at classifying audio, and they, you know, work surprisingly well even for music. But they definitely don't include any of the note information. They were designed to remove the pitches from speech. We can hear that if we, you know, whatever we try and do, if we try and resynthesize what information they contain, there are no notes left. And, you know, it turns out that we don't have to know about the notes to be able to do good artist identification. And, you know, if you're just talking about the individual notes, they all use the same notes, right? So it probably isn't that good to try and distinguish between different artists just by looking at the notes. But there are lots of reasons why we would want to look at the notes. We might want to do things like taking audio and picking out the melody so we could sort of match melodies or do a query by humming type thing. There's this idea of trying to transcribe the music into chords, which could be interesting, again, for finding similar pieces of music or for like musicological questions of understanding how chords are used and how songs are structured. And there's a specific problem of detecting cover songs. You have two different performances of the same piece of music, but they're, you know, designed to be different by the artists. But you might want to be able to find the others in response to a query given one of them. How would you match them? Well, looking at the notes, but sort of stripping away the instrumentation, that's kind of what you'd want to be able to do. So MFCCs aren't going to be any good for this. If we had a system that could actually take a piece of music and tell us what all the notes that were being played are, that would be great. That's polyphonic transcription. It's taking the polyphonic, the multi-instrument recording, and converting it into a score, a set of individual notes. But it's not very reliable. So this is the output of a piano transcription system, a polyphonic piano transcription system that we did, where, again, actually, this was also based on supervised learning. This one was based on SVMs. We took a bunch of piano recordings where we knew what the notes were because they came from a player piano, a MIDI piano. And then we trained classifiers to say, well, this is an example of a piece of audio that has a C4 in it, and this one doesn't. So it has an individual binary classifier detector for each note. And then we run on that. And so the true notes are shown in blue, and the recognition output is shown in red, and it gets a lot of them. It works quite well, but it misses some of these notes just because, you know, the energy was below some threshold. And it also makes these sort of false alarms. The false alarms are normally very have an obvious relationship to what's going on. So here, these two ones are, you know, this is MIDI 64 and this is MIDI 76. So they're an octave above, 12 semitones above what a note that was actually played, which is this thing that, well, if you have a C4, it contains all the harmonics of C5. C5 is double the frequency, so you just take the even-numbered harmonics of C4 and you get C5. And so there are these common problems that afflict transcription. And of course, this is an easy case because it's just piano. In a normal piece of music, we'd have different instruments, and then this approach wouldn't work nearly so well because the different instruments would have different characteristics. So Chroma features are basically a way of sidestepping this problem. So what are they? Well, the idea is we take the energy of our signal, our music signal, which is, you know, lots of different frequencies, whatever, the 88 keys of the piano keyboard plus their harmonics. And we say, well, we don't need all that detail. In many cases, what all we really care about is which key within a single octave, within a single 12 semitones of an octave, which one of those is present. And then we'll forget about which octave it's in. And the thing is that, you know, if you take the same melody and then you play it an octave higher, it's still the same melody. Even if you play it at the same time, that works out okay. And so the insight here is that for musical purposes, for melodic and harmonic purposes, just knowing the degree of this scale within a single octave is enough information. And then, of course, the way we can do this is by saying, well, we've got all these different frequencies. For each frequency, I'm just going to map it to one of these 12 bins. So you have this, you know, the spectrogram here, which is however many time frames by, you know, 512 frequency bins. And I have this mapping matrix here. I guess it's only 250. It's actually 200-odd bins here, but then only 12 rows. And so when I multiply these two together, I get this thing which just gives me 12 values for each time frame. So like the MFCCs, we've now taken this fairly complex piece of audio and we've described it with a much smaller, more compact feature vector. And that's always a good thing, because if you're going to do these machine learning tasks, if you're going to try and learn these Gaussian models, which are like, you know, some point in high-dimensional space, you don't want to have to learn that point in thousand-dimensional space, because, you know, thousand-dimensional space is awfully large. You need a lot of training points before you can accurately define this point. But if it's lower dimensional, if it's 10 or 12 dimensional, then okay, if we can still distinguish things we need to distinguish, if it works for us, then that's going to be a good thing to keep it down to 12 dimensions. So here I'm trying to define what this mapping is. Basically, we have the spectral magnitude here. We have some weighting function here, which basically says, you know what, I don't really care about frequencies above 2 kilohertz. They're not, you know, all the notes on the piano are sort of below that frequency. You'll get harmonics above that frequency, but they're not, turns out they don't have a very strong effect on perceived pitch. And same for very, very low notes. So we have some weighting which sort of prefers frequencies in this so-called pitch dominance range, which is the range of frequencies which are known to give the strongest impression of pitch. And then for each frequency, we have a mapping function here, which basically looks at the frequency, the log 2, the frequency mapped onto an octave, multiplies that by 12, and then takes a difference from some bin center and weights it by that. K is the index of the FFT bin, or I guess, yeah, it doesn't matter. It's just a scale factor. K0 is some origin, just a constant origin. NM is the number of bins that we're using in our FFT. Right, so NM is this dimension here. So I haven't defined B, because I want this thing to obviously to select when the fractional part of 12 times the log base 2 of K is some particular number. And so B now is doing my fractional part for me. It's a mapping that has a peak around 0, but then also has a peak around 12 and 24. But that's what I'm plotting here, basically. It's saying that for a given frequency, for a given chroma bin, I select some FFT bins, then the ones that double that frequency, the ones that double that frequency, and the ones that double that frequency, because those are all the frequencies that are octaves of a single note. This particular spectrogram is a chromatic scale played on the piano. Let's just listen to that. So you can see, you know, these are the harmonics, the individual piano notes. They're always regularly spaced, but as we get up in as we move up in frequency, they're getting spaced further and further apart. When we do the mapping here that maps, you know, both this frequency and this frequency and this frequency all get mapped to an A. What that means is, you know, this point and, you know, this point are all basically being mapped to the same energy bin. And so we get this, we get these, each note now, you know, basically hits one of these chroma bins, but then as we sort of go off the top of this chroma scale, we wrap around the bottom. So it's actually like a circular scale. There's no natural origin here. They're all, I could have started with C. In fact, people normally start with C. Here I started with A, but it looks the same. And you can see that those individual piano notes pretty much line up with a single, this one dominant chroma bin here. A couple of things we do notice, the two adjacent chroma bins also get a bit of energy. This is to do with how I, well, maybe it's to do with my FFT, that there's a little bit of, you know, side lobes to my FFT bins, or how I did this mapping here that, you know, I can't just choose a single frequency. You also notice that there's a little bit of energy up here. This is actually, so for here's C, and we see it also has energy in the G bin, which is 7 semitones higher. That's because the third harmonic of C, this harmonic here, that this is, if this is C2 or something, which is like 120, 130 hertz, then this is an octave higher, which would be 260 hertz, but this is 3 times F0, 390 hertz. This is actually the frequency of G3, G, a fifth, an octave and a fifth above the lowest note. So that fifth thing comes in there, and we see there's a little bit of energy there. So it isn't, the chroma isn't doing a perfect job of telling us just the single note that's being played, but it does have this property of, well, it mostly tells us about a single note, and it maps all these different octaves together without having to worry about separating out individual notes. So that's what the chroma is. There's been some work to try and improve, get better performing chroma. One of the things that I've worked on is, rather than just having this straight kind of matrix multiply where we take every FFT bin and put its energy somewhere, you try and assign the individual points of the FFT to specific frequencies by using this instantaneous frequency, which is sort of related to what we were doing with the phase vocoder. You look at how much the phase changes within the FFT bin. That tells you the d phi dt, which is omega, the frequency. And so what that does is, if you have several FFT bins which are sort of spread out, they tend to get condensed into a single frequency because they've all got the same phase advance. And plus, that frequency is no longer quantized to FFT bins. It's able to give you resolution below the level of the FFT bins. So you map all your FFT bins to particular frequencies, and then you can just assign those frequencies into discrete bins. That does a pretty good job. So this is the same chromatic scale, and now we can see we don't have these blurring of adjacent bins, but we still have the problem that the third harmonic will give us the fifth, give us the, you know, this particular note, which has multiple harmonics, the first, second, fourth, and eighth will all fall on the right chroma bin. They're all Cs of different octaves. But the third, which is the most energetic one, the lowest indexed one that isn't an octave, will fall on an octave and a fifth, so you get this ghosting. And then actually, you know, the seventh is an octave and a third. You can see that little bit there. But it's okay. Another thing you have to be, obviously we've got these hard boundaries between the bins. We want to make sure they do actually line up with the frequencies in the piece. And so most chroma systems have to have some kind of adaptive tuning where they sort of look at the whole spectrum first and they try and, you know, make a fine tuning of their chroma basis so that you get that falls, each note falls right in the middle of the chroma bin. Okay, so that's the chroma representation. When we wanted to figure out what the MFCC was really capturing, we had this idea of trying to regenerate sound so we could hear a sound for which this was the ideal kind of representation, and we could see what was being kept. For chroma, we can't, it's not clear exactly how we do that, but one thing we can do is, like, what the chroma says, well, there's this much energy for C at this point in time, but I don't know which octave it's in. So what you can do is you can generate a set of sinusoids at all possible octaves of that, of a C, and you can just modulate those by the energy. Now, you could do it for all frequencies at all, you know, across the entire audible range. But there are these things called the shepherd tone, where you sort of have this, you have a sinusoid whose magnitude varies with this kind of envelope here. And the nice thing about these, the shepherd tone actually, by definition, has all the harmonics present. So it's a set of sinusoids in octave relations, like 1, 2, 4, 8, 16 times some fundamental, with this shape. And then if you, they were developed by this guy, Roger Shepherd, if you sweep the frequency up such that there are always harmonics disappearing out the top and then new ones coming in the bottom, you hear this pitch where you can hear that the frequency is rising, because it is, but it rises forever because it never actually disappears, because it's always disappearing out the top and coming in at the back, but slowly enough that you don't really hear those individual pieces, so it's this continuously rising tone. Okay, so we can use a set of 12 of these tones, one for each chroma bin, modulate their energy, and we can resynthesize. And so the chromatic scale on the piano would sound like this. So there it's like a continuously ascending scale. This is the spectrum of it. Basically, it repeats, but it has this local continuity, but it doesn't really go anywhere. Okay, so we understand what the theory of chroma is. Now let's do it to a real piece of music. So here's Let It Be again. Here is the chroma feature. So now we're doing the same 30 millisecond windows, but now instead of calculating MFCCs, we're calculating these chroma for each frame. And you can see that they're nice and discrete, and they're quite well defined. And so here is putting this into the chroma, into the shepherd tone resynthesis. Let's listen to that. So we can hear the individual notes, sort of. Has a little bit more trouble with the voice. It works well on the piano because we're basically putting everything into these 12 bins, and the piano notes really are in those 12 bins. The voice, because there's vibrato in the voice here. You can't really see it on this, but it's not exactly in the middle of a bin. The chroma representation just has to put it into one bin or another, so it flickers between these adjacent bins. But it's basically, you probably, if you heard that and you didn't know what it was, you'd probably be able to recognize that it was Let It Be. I don't know. We can make it sound better by combining those two things. So before we had Let It Be, which was like the crashing, noisy sound. Now we've got the notes. Instead of using the noise to as the excitation of the MFCCs, we can take this thing we just heard, use that as the input to the broad spectrum from the MFCCs, and then resynthesize that, and that sounds like this. So that's interesting. I mean, it's kind of, I don't know, it obviously doesn't sound quite right, but it's not, we've thrown away a lot of the information, right? We're taking each 30 millisecond frame, which even a reasonable sampling rate would be 500 points or something, and representing it by two sets of 12 coefficients, 12 chroma vectors, and then 12 MFCCs. And so it's a fairly large data reduction, but when we listen to what we resynthesize, we've captured quite a lot of the original content. Still, for the purposes of data analysis, I'd like to reduce the data still further. And so there's this idea of also using the beat tracking and then only storing a certain amount of data for every beat. So what we can do is we can take the original music, we do the beat tracking using the beat tracking algorithm we spoke about last week, and then for each beat segment, we just store one set of features for each beat segment or for each event segment. And so here's the beat tracking on Let It Be. interesting because it doesn't do that well when the voice comes in. It's confused because, you know, it's this dynamic programming beat thing which tries to find these times which line up with these nice onsets. But when it's singing is not quite on the beat, it prefers to try and line up a beat with you know, the beginning of a syllable or something. But it's still got sort of the right number of beats. So then we do this thing of just averaging the chroma from the previous slide within each beat segment. That gives us this representation, which is now very sparse, right? We've only got like 3 or 4 chroma vectors per second. And we can resynthesize that, get this. You can hear that the notes are fixed for every beat segment. And again, it works pretty well on the piano. When the voice comes in, the voice is actually, the pitch is changing within each beat, and so it sort of has to average that out, which doesn't necessarily sound that good. Sometimes it sort of sounds like it resolves to the not the canonical semitone, not the right note. But now we're representing, you know, each second of audio with maybe, you know, 50 or 60 coefficients rather than 16,000. So it's a very compact representation. What am I going to say about it? Okay. We can use this for as a basis for recognizing chords. So now we've got a representation where we really could think about trying to transcribe at least parts of this. This is the actual beat synchronous chroma from the previous slide. What we see here is that you can pretty much just read off the actual notes that are being played. I mean, this is the easiest case. This is a nice piano triad. But if you look, you know, it starts in C major, and here it is. The C, the E, and the G are the three highest bends here, pretty clearly. And then, you know, here's the whatever it is, the it looks like G major, right? Yeah. G, G, D, G, B, and D. Yeah. Is that right? B, D, whatever, anyway. These are the actual correct notes for the actual triads at the beginning of the piece. And so, okay, well, why don't we build a system which just learns what these things are and transcribes them? And so we can, now we've got this 12-dimensional thing, and we can again think about our 12-dimensional space as a set of points, each one for each frame, and then we can look at the distribution and try and look for clusters in that space where we can learn what's going on. There's actually a pretty popular approach, which is just to say, well, I know what a C major chord is. It's these three notes. So I'll have a predefined template. I'll just look for high energy in those bins, and that will, you know, I'll have a set of templates and find the one that fits best. The more kind of machine learning approach is to say, well, I don't particularly know how the data is going to show up in these, in these examples, but I'll get some labeled examples. So I'll say, okay, well, I know this is C major and G major or whatever, and you, the machine, can figure out what the distribution is of these points, these cluster of points in feature space, and learn like a Gaussian model for those, something like that. So that's the approach that we've pursued. So this was something I did a long time ago, actually, with a master's student who was interested in music. This was kind of before we were doing much work in music in my group. But he basically took the, Alex Shea was his name, he took a standard speech recognition framework, which is a hidden Markov model with Gaussian mixture models of the features. And instead of, but normally you use that to learn phonemes, to learn words, and he used it instead to learn chords, to learn pieces of music, or to learn chord sequences. But basically, it's kind of what we expect. We have the audio, we have some chroma calculation. The system that we ended up using uses two different frequency bands and calculates the chroma in a low frequency band, which picks up the root note, and then in a middle sorry, the low frequency band picks up the root note, and the middle frequency band which picks up the melody note or the main structure. We do these on a beat synchronous basis, and then we've got some training data which gives us labels, and this one source of training data, which is what we're going to use on Wednesday, these guys at Queen Mary University of London, this guy Chris Hart in particular, went through and manually labeled all 180 tracks that were recorded by the Beatles for each of the chords. So we have this very good, nice training data. We then, for the training data, we rotate the chroma vector so that it's all, so they're normalized with their root. We then learn a Gaussian model, a Gaussian distribution. Then we unnormalize, and that gives us a set of 24 models, one for each major chord, one for each minor chord, rooted on each note of the chromatic scale. And we have them as means and covariance matrices. We also have a transition matrix, which tells us how likely each chord is to follow a different chord. And that's the input you need for a hidden Markov model. Then we can do recognition by doing the finding the most likely path through that hidden Markov model. I don't really have time to give you the one slide summary of a hidden Markov model here, unfortunately. But basically, you have a state machine which tells you, which says, well, we think what's going on with this data is there's some underlying state, but the state has some emission. The emission is kind of probabilistic. So here, you know, they're saying, well, the values, if it's in state A, it's going to be about 1, a little bit of noise. That's one particular instance. But we could have a situation here where if it's in state A, it's going to be something like this. But if I get a value in here, it could be any of these states, because this value is under the distributions of all these different states. So if we had a sequence like this with this kind of distribution model, we get an observation sequence like this. It's hard to draw the boundaries between the different states here. But the hidden Markov model tools allow you to find a particular label sequence which is the most likely one, which has the best chance of coming from that data, taking into account both these distributions and these probabilities of transitions between particular frames. That's exactly what you need to do chord recognition. We want to do some stuff on key normalization, so we look at the overall global covariance matrix for the different chroma frames. And it turns out that if you do that, you get certain notes which occur a lot and certain notes which never occur together. And you can find a rotation of the, you know, a key that makes those things line up the best. So you can do that. You can make all the pieces be in the same key, because then you can learn the transitions and the probabilities of different chords relative to the key, which is what makes sense musically. And you can get pretty good results. So these are actually a couple of years old now. But this is the kind of system we get. So here's the original spectrogram. Here are the ground truth labels. Here are the beat synchronous chroma. And here is the output of the recognition. And this is the beginning of Let It Be, C major, G major, A minor. That's my symbol for A minor. Chris Hart says that it's an A minor with a flattened seventh for the last beat. My system doesn't know about flattened sevenths, so it just calls that A minor. And here's F major and F major sixth. Again, those both become F. But it basically, for that stretch, it's getting it right. Here are some accuracy results. Just learning 24 separate models gives me 54% correct. If I split it up into two streams, the middle stream and the bass note stream, it goes up to 55. And then if I do this rotation to make all the models, learn a single model for all the different keys, that goes up to 58%. This current systems are pushing over 70% correct for this kind of task. So that's it. We talked about the idea of trying to represent music with features, and then some specific features, the MFCCs, which are the most common features, or the statistics of the MFCCs are the most common features. Chroma features is this alternative that picks up the tonal information without the instrumentation. And these have actually, we've used these for cover song recognition quite successfully, and I'll show you some of that later on. And then the particular application in chord recognition, where we learn distributions of these chroma features to recognize chords. Any questions about that stuff? Okay, so on Wednesday we'll actually be working with MATLAB, but we'll run a real chord recognition system which you can train on some labeled data and evaluate and see how well it works.